see Amy Gaskin. She's going to come up and give us an inspirational pitch. Reagan, know the bar is very high for you because I don't know if you've ever heard Amy before, but she's an amazing speaker. She's got a wealth of experience, and so please welcome her up to the stage.
So the timing for this couldn't be better, I guess, for this particular talk, which is Between Two Worlds. This is about open data policy in Saudi Arabia, which you may not have really thought about before. As you know, or may not know, yesterday both houses of Congress passed a bill allowing 9/11 families to sue Saudi Arabia for damages caused by 9/11. So, this is something that's really interesting. I'm not a lobbyist. This is just based on my own experience there. So has anybody in here been to Saudi Arabia? They don't have tourism, so this was my first trip, so don't worry. Okay, so salam. Assalamu alaikum. So I want to give a little bit of background. Yeah, the picture's me without my face veil. This was me in Riyadh, in my hotel room at the Marriott. And a little bit of background about this trip. I was invited by a group to present at a conference on big data. So at the time, I was the big data project director at NOAA. And I was the only female speaker at this conference. I was one of two Americans. So it was really, really interesting. There were only three female attendees, and they all sat at a table in the back. I was able to sit up front. I presented dressed like this, and I sat with a table of men, which was really interesting, in particular academics and technology folks from large Saudi companies. And they were very, very nice to me. Arab hospitality is notorious. So I spoke about digital democracy, not on the NOAA Big Data Project. I went on leave to take this to do this conference, and the government did not pay for it. But when I came back, it ended up ultimately costing me my job because of some of the stuff that I'm about to tell you today. So it's actually quite interesting because disliking the Saudis is very fashionable right now in DC. So when you think about Saudi Arabia, what do you think about? You think about things like terrorism, women who can't drive, you know, oil, what else? Beheadings. Some of the guys even made jokes about that, which was a little strange, but also showed that they had an interesting sense of humor about their own culture. And you think about big things like the Hajj. What you don't think about, what about open data? So it's not something you think about when you think about Saudi society, right? Do you think Saudi Arabia has an open data portal? They do. And it's in Arabic and in English, which is really interesting. So right now, it's been populated within the last like year or so. And it's largely Excel spreadsheets and things like that, but it shows that all of these Saudi ministries are making a very concerted effort to open up their data to the public because they know that they can't just rely on oil revenue anymore, and they're starting to branch out into other industries. And open data and open government is something that they're very interested in, which was to my surprise. So the question is, do you see something familiar? So on the left is the Saudi Open Data Portal. On the right is data.gov. And they look very similar, right? And there's a reason for that. So 18F and the digital services are putting their code online, and it's available. So the Saudis are cribbing a lot of our stuff. And I'm about to go back. If you were here for the lightning talks last night, the city of Raleigh and NC State was doing the LiDAR and the shadowing and 3D modeling of the city and proposed policy plans. Well, I had seen somebody from King Abdullah University of Science and Technology present the exact same thing in April when I went to Riyadh. And I said, oh, I'm going to get you in touch with those guys so you can crib their code because they'll probably give it to you. So you can finish up your project a lot faster and use whatever grant money you have to do other stuff. So pretty cool that we can make that connection. So this is the kind of depressing thing. So the UN does e-government surveys and ranks every country in the world on their e-government services. So I'm looking from like 2004 to 2016. So the one for this year just came out. In 2004, the United States was first, and now it's number 12. In 2004, the Saudis were number 90, and now they're number 44. So when you look at how fast they're moving up the ranks, it's incredible the amount of effort and how quickly they're moving. The United Arab Emirates is the same way. They've moved from, I think, number 60 to number 29. So they're catching up really fast. So while I was in Saudi Arabia, the Vision 2030 announcement came out. This is, you know, government transformation, and there's a huge, huge push for digital. It was launched by Mohammed bin Salman bin Abdul Aziz Al Saud. That's a mouthful, so I need to look at it. And really, one of the things that they're looking at is the promotion of government transparency, which is fantastic. And you can go read the entire thing online, and there are executive summaries and things like that. But one of their goals for 2030 is to put themselves in the top 5 in that UN e-government ranking. That's very ambitious, and they are pushing ahead. They have a very solid plan to do this, which would pass the United States, since we're number 12 right now. Just some food for thought. And so they have a short-term national transformation plan for the next 4 years, which is to 2020, and they're pouring hundreds of millions of dollars into IT solutions, whether it's hardware. They're working to get their entire nation online to put, you know, cables and fiber all throughout the entire country and get everybody internet access within the next 4 years, which is quite remarkable. So what's next? So I'm not naive about the difficulties of this kind of stuff. And the Saudis have a fairly authoritarian regime, which can make these kinds of transformations easier because they can just push it down and make it happen. So, but I'm not naive about, you know, some of the political issues and things like that. So I was a counterterrorism officer for a long time at the Defense Intelligence Agency, so I know that region very well. But these decisions are being made at the highest level of government. So these are not democratic issues, but they're being made by people who were largely educated outside Saudi Arabia. This is a different class of people, if you will, and it's being pushed down to the populace. And then, but I do think that many smart Saudis really understand the importance of open data and open government. When I talked to them, one of the things I said when I came back was they get it. They're putting money toward it, and if we don't watch out, they're going to pass us. So the political point is that I was talking to the government, we're really not happy with this. And I said, look, don't shoot the messenger, right? The numbers don't lie, and I've talked to them. NOAA had an international relations group with no representation in the Middle East. And when I cornered some of those folks and asked why not, they said it was because nobody in the agency had any experience with the Middle East, so they just avoided it, like pretended like it didn't exist. Which largely happens. If you work in government, you understand. So I think it's really interesting, and it's something that we should watch together, right? If anything, it lights a little fire under us to say, we know these things are coming. How do we plan for it? And how do we keep America great? Not in the Donald Trump way, unless I doubt there are Trump supporters in here, but there might be. But how do we make e-government, how do we move back up the rankings, right? How do we move from number 12 to number 1 again? Because to watch us slip off the top 10 gave me a really sad feeling. And to say, oh, how do we move back up? You know, it's about people like you. It's not a government problem to solve completely, where the Saudis are saying, yeah, it's a government problem to solve, but everyone's the government. So I say, you know, together, let's watch, and let's talk, right? If we need to crib some of the Saudi stuff, great. But let's have an open conversation with them about what they're doing, because everybody's got something to learn from each other. So that is the crux. If I've got time, or I'm trying to get us back on schedule. So if you have any questions about it, please come talk to me. I'm happy to introduce you to any Saudis that might be of interest to you. But I think, you know, they're really interesting folks. And they also have a lot of money to invest. So if you know, they have a $10 trillion sovereign wealth fund. They just gave $3 billion to Uber as an investment. So they're serious about technology, and they're putting their money where their mouth is. So if you have a startup and you can get over the Saudi thing, you know, come talk to me.
All right, let's thank Amy.
All right.